Hello everyone, welcome back. So Mr. Krishna Suri will take over now.
Okay, madam. Thank you, madam. Okay, welcome back. So I will start with the resume with the additional features. There are encryption and collection DB, application level encryption. So till now in the first half, we have seen the transaction is submitted in the plain text format. So all the channel members, who are all the participants of the network, right? They are able to access the entire data. So that is anyway, we are providing a way of privacy that is only the channel members are able to have access to the data. So there is privacy already. But as I said at the beginning, there are additional possible confidentiality mechanisms provided as part of Fabric. So this is encryption is one such confidentiality mechanism. So in this case, what happens is that the transaction input can be encrypted and submitted to the chain code, and so the transaction input is submitted in the encrypted format, and the chain code, when it is executing, it will decrypt the transaction, and once at the end of the chain code execution, the world state is again, as we know, right, there are two components that we need to register with each peer, that is the transaction itself, the block, and then the world state. So already the transaction is in encrypted format, so it will be stored, included in the block as is. Only thing is that the world state, earlier it was tracking the keys and their values in plain text format. Now it will be encrypted as well, right? So this is the one kind of confidentiality that is achieved. So there is one more level of confidentiality, that is use of private data collection. This is part of the releases 1.2 onwards, 1.1 onwards, and in fact now this is one of the major features used in Fabric. What it does is that when you compare with 1.0, that is earlier releases of Fabric versus the subsequent releases, the data privacy across channels is only guaranteed. Data privacy is guaranteed within channel also, starting from 1.1, which means is that if you are the member of a channel, only then you have access to the data. So this is how the privacy is guaranteed here. If you are not member of the channel, you don't have access to the channel data. Now, that is, you cannot see the transaction data if you are not member of the channel. Now here in this case, even though you are a member of the channel, still you may or may not see the channel data. That's how, as you have now seen, the transaction, if it is encrypted, you cannot see the transaction data even though you are a member of the channel. So similarly, there are other mechanisms. So one such mechanism is data, private data collection, which we will see in this session. Now, transaction proposal and work state read write sets visible to all peers connected to the channel. So this is the existing behavior. So read write sets, anybody can see it, including the ordering service. Now, transaction proposal and read write sets are available only to some selected participants, right? So this is the changed behavior. Similarly, ordering service has access to read write sets, even though ordering service does nothing with the transaction read write sets. As you can recollect from the transaction workflow, the different stages of transaction execution, ordering service never validates any transaction, whether the transaction read sets are proper, write sets are proper. It does anything. It only considers randomly the transactions submitted by different clients, and using its own technique, there can be different methods it can follow internally. Probably, for example, it don't want to stall any transaction from including any block for a long time, because that will be one quality of service agreement that the ordering service may be trying to achieve. That even though it can delay the transactions, so the ordering service, even though it has that capability, whether to include a transaction in a block or not, it also needs to adhere to certain service level quality agreements, right? So one such thing could be that any given transaction, there is a max amount of time before which it is ensured that it will be part of a block, right? One such guarantee can be, it is one such goal, right? So even though Artex service is adhering to such goals and carrying out its activities, at no point in time it accesses the transaction data. Still, it has access to read write sets, plain text. If it wants to manipulate something, it can do it. But it there is no, as per the protocol, there is no step it needs to do with the read and write sets. So in that case, why do you want to give access to read write sets to the order? So if it is possible just to hide this read write set from the order, let us hide that. So that's what is being done in Fabric 1.1. This is how it is done. Instead of keeping the read write sets, hash of read write set is associated in the transaction, so that from the hash, the ordering service cannot learn anything. Even if it wants to access the read write set, it can't learn anything. So that's how the privacy is achieved. So so these are all the some of the levels of privacy. So that means that within the channel itself, not all members will be able to have access to the read write set, and only to the permissioned peers in the channel the read write set is exposed for access, and the ordering service also cannot have access to the read write set to the transaction. So how we achieve this, we will see it. So for example, so assume that we have three types of data associated with the transaction. One is the public data with the transaction, which can be seen by everybody in the network. So that is what we represent using the green box here. And the second kind of category of data, right? So the gray color, that actually consists of the data which can be accessed by only the organization members, but not the ordering service. So any member of the any organization which is part of this channel, they can have access to this kind of data. So this is the second category. Similarly, there is a third category, which is among the organization participants also, only certain participants can have access to this data. So that is the third category, which we track using red color over here. So if we have this type of three different categories of transaction data, again, just to remember the fact that this is all associated data with one transaction only, but we are now partitioning that data into three different buckets as per the whoever the users who can have access to that data. So as per the access possibility, we are putting into three different buckets. Now, what happens to this green bucket? It is accessible by everybody, so there is no need to do anything with respect to the existing transaction behavior. So it is available on the public channel data, and it goes to everybody, orderers and peers, including every participant, they can access it. Okay, so here what is marvelous is if you see Hyperledger Fabric, the source code in the GitHub repository, there are certain examples actually which you can download and configure and exercise whether the asset transfer is happening among the different network participants of Fabric network. So one of the assets is marbles, and how it's tracked, or how the different transactions actually act on the different marbles. So that is one example actually. So they are just taking the data of the marbles. So each marble consists of a name, size, color, and owner. Current owner of the marble. And so this information, for example, assume that can be seen by any organization member of this channel. Whereas there is a price associated with the marble, only the owner of the marble we want to expose this data to. So in that case, we'll keep that only organization one members can see the price. So this is the private data actually. So in this scenario, so these two both are private data, but the level of privacy is different. So this is only to specific organization members. This is to all organization members. So what happens is that the collection marbles, this data is part of private data for channel peers and goes into peers, but not orders. This is private data for subset of channel peers and goes to subset of peers only. And how we manage this data, we will see in the next slide. So what we have is that Till now we have only the state database and a ledger. Only two components are there. Now we will have a state database and a ledger. Similarly, a private state database. So for example, the price of the marble, that is a private state. What is the price? So that is stored in a separate database, which is called private DB. And similarly, we have a private store, which will write, which will keep track of these keys that are part of the private state. In addition to these two, we have private transient DB. Actually, because why this is called transient DB is that it keeps track of some information till the part, till the transaction is submitted, starting from endorsement phase to ending at the validation phase. Once the validation is done, transaction execution is complete, then the transient database is cleared for this transaction. Whatever the transient database is hosting with respect to a transaction, that is cleared at the end of validation phase. So that is why it is called transient DB. So we will see for this example, what are the different contents of this. So when the transaction is submitted for the marbles transaction with this level of data segregation, so initially only the marbles data collection information is consumed by only the peers. No orderer will have access to this. So what will happen is that the transient database will contain the write sets. So here note that the write set, the name, size, color, owner, each of these keys is also part of the private transaction DB, right? Now the second part of the private data, that is the price. Now the price value is only with organization one. So this is part of only the private state and also private transient DB of this arg1 only. Here you can see the policy is arg1. So it can be associated with arg1 peers only. So arg1 peers only are having this data, right? So this is where, and you can very clearly see that this data is not shared with the arg2. What will happen is that at the time of endorsement, the endorsers anyway will have access to entire data. They will actually keep this in the private transient DB and execute the transaction. The transaction read set, write sets, they have to respond back to the client, right? When they are sending read set, write sets, if any read set is a part of this public state DB, it will be released in the plaintext format. If any read set or write set is part of private state DB, then what will happen? The hash of the write set is sent as part of transaction proposal, and the actual information about the change, for example, the write set is changing the key value from value 5 to 25. So the version is changing version 2 to version 3. So that information is tracked in the transient DB, whereas the hash of this key is committed to the along with the transaction data. So that's what we meant by hash, associating the hash. So by just looking at the hash, nobody knows why the hash is needed. At the time of validation, any peer, they can see that, okay, this peer is also having access to the private data. They will check whether the hash of this is actually what is included as part of the transaction or not. So that's how they will validate whether any endorser is properly doing the validation or not. So that's what I said. At the time of transaction submission, the public keys in the part of public state DB are part of the transaction as plain text. The private keys, which are part of private state DB, are hashed and the hash values are included here. So one other thing that to note is that here the missing private data. It is possible that due to some reason, the private data is missing with some organization. So what they do at the time of validation is that they know that from the collection information, which are all the peers who have access to this private data. So one of them, they can connect and pull the private data. So now you can see from the previous slide, the private transient DB with this peer is empty, nothing is there. Now you can see that the private transient DB is full. So what happened is that there is a specific step in this step, the peer, which is bearing the role of committing peer, that is validating the transaction, it will know that I don't have currently access to the private data. Hence, let me pull the data from one of the peers who have access to the private data. How it knows? By looking at the collection. There is a collection, right? One special component. In that collection, it knows that, okay, who are all the other members who have access to this private data, it knows. And one of them, it will reach out and pulls the data. So once it has this data, it can now again proceed for the validation. What it does as part of validation, anyway, the public keys, it knows how to do validate. It will do endorsement policy and the MVCC check, double spending check. And for the private keys, it computes the hash of this right set, and it will check whether the hash is matching with whatever is included in the transaction. If that matches, then well and good, the transaction is accepted. Otherwise, the transaction is failed. If transaction is accepted, then it is the same way. We update the state database with the latest value of the keys. We update the ledger, that is the blockchain, by adding the new block into the blockchain. So similarly, whatever we are doing here with the private state also, we do the same thing as a separate record. So these two are now maintained as separate entities. So once this is done, the private transient DB is deleted. So that's all. That is the how the private data collections is implemented. So that is the one of the popular ways. So advantage with this is that you can simultaneously share the private data with not just one peer, but whoever is the peer part of the private data collection, they will all be able to see the private data, the same image at the same time. So that is the biggest advantage, and there is no need for any encryption or decryption in the process of achieving confidentiality. So here you can understand the fact that this private data collection is achieving the objective of providing different level of confidentiality. What it means is that only the private data collection members will be able to access this data, but not other peers. So this is the level of confidentiality, and this is the most easiest way to implement, so that transaction throughput is also not happening. So now we will look into some of the flagship networks that Fabric has. So TradeLens first are the flagship networks that IBM blockchain, Fabric blockchain has. That IBM is maintaining. So
हेलो सर, आपका वॉइस में इश्यू हो रहा है, आप वीडियो म्यूट कर दीजिए अपना. हाँ सर, आप अपना वीडियो बंद कर दीजिए, ऑडियो से बैंडविड्थ की वजह से थोड़ा इश्यू आ रहा है. आप एक बार माइक को म्यूट और अनम्यूट कर लीजिए सर.
Please give me 1 minute. I think I don't know. It is halting my server. My system is halting. Please give me 1 minute, sir.
Okay. Okay.
Okay, can you hear me better now? Hello?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, so I switched off my video. I think yes, I hope sir. That is fine. Yeah, so okay. Yeah, let me go ahead with the TradeLens. So these are the flagship networks that are configured on top of, that are maintained on top of Hyperledger Fabric blockchain network. So one is the TradeLens network, which is a network for global trade participants, and Food Trust network. So I want to go over another third flagship network that we cater to few clients, that is e-invoice generation network. So that is a value added service on top of TradeLens network. So we will see the details of all three starting from TradeLens. So TradeLens is a business network that is intended to be used by the global trade participants. So before jumping into what is global trade, let me give you a simple example. Trade means any supply chain transaction where buying and selling is involved, right? So buying means somebody is buying, that is called whoever is, that is called the buyer, and somebody is selling, that somebody is called seller. So this can be one organization who is selling the goods, and this can be one organization who is buying the goods. Now, if it is, for example, Amazon case, if you are going onto Amazon portal and buying some goods, then you are the buyer, Amazon is the seller. You will buy the transaction, you will buy one specific product there, a toy or something, that specific product is packaged and shipped to your address, delivery address. Once the package is shipped, you will get the invoice also. That is the that is called in the terminology of trade as the EDI document, EDI, electronic data interchange EDI document. So invoice is accompanied as part of your product at the time of delivery. Then you will be paying against to the invoice because you received the goods. Again, there are different modes of payment. The one payment method, maybe you prepay the amount, or at the time of delivery you may be paying, right? And at the time of paying also you can pay by cash, by card. There are different ways. So that is a simple transaction. Now consider the scenario, the same transaction that is happening between the buyer and the seller. This is the buyer and this is the seller, where they are located in two different countries. Now this is called global trade because the transaction is happening across parties located in different countries. Now what are the additional complexities that we need to consider in case of global trade? So in case of this global trade, what happens? For example, I am buying some equipment. I being an organization, I am buying some equipment which is sold by some equipment manufacturer. So what has to be done? That equipment has to be packaged into a container. Typically, this is how the global trade happens, right? So the specific my shipment, I call this, that can be any shipment, right? Anything, any gift or any raw materials or anything. So that is my shipment. My shipment is packaged into a container, and third party logistic service, 3PLs, they come into picture. They will help move my shipment from the beneficiary cargo owner, BCO, the seller to the towards me. The shipment needs to be moved from the seller to the buyer, that is me. So the movement is happening with the help of different participants in between who are responsible to clear different things as part of the goods movement. So the first thing is the 3PL, third party logistic service providers. They actually provide the drayage service. They come into picture. They by looking at my shipment, they will first pack my shipment into a container. Then that container is loaded into a inland service, for example, a lorry. And then, so just 1 minute. Hello? No, I'm in a meeting, sorry. So then the inland service, for example, the lorry, it is carrying the container from the pickup location towards the port location. Because now it is between countries, the shipment needs to be transported. Typically, these cargo ships are used for the transportation between the different ports of the countries. So this can be from US to, this can be Mumbai in India, the goods needs to be shipped. So there is a ocean carrier, Maersk, for example, is involved in this shipment process. So at some port in US, the shipment is loaded onto the carrier, and the carrier will carry the shipment, the container, to the destination port, that is Mumbai port, for example. And once at the Mumbai port, the shipment is arrived, then again there is a custom clearance process that happens, and then the shipment is released from the carrier, and again the shipment needs to be delivered at some buyer's location, right? That may be within the city. So there is again a land carrier that comes into picture. So third party logistic provider by the importing country. So here please remember the fact that 3PL is the third party logistic provider. This is the provider within the importing country, whereas the 3PL here is the export country. Similarly, the dryage provider and the custom authorities. So we see at the both ends, at the export location, at the import location, similar processes happening in the reverse order, right? So, and these are the different organizations you can see. So 3PL itself, here the organization, it can be Gati Courier, for example. It can be any other courier service which is helping with the goods movement process. Similarly, the dryage provider can be different, and the carrier, it can be Maersk or any other carrier, right? So there are different organizations involved in the goods movement in the process of one transaction, and these different organizations typically they use their own they follow their own processes, and they use their own databases to track the shipments and the progress of the shipment transportation status and all. So information is typically siloed, and even though we are seeing as a end user, the buyer of the goods, we don't have, if you want to have visibility into where your goods is at a particular point in time, you need to ideally connect to different organizations. If it is a carrier is carrying the shipment for 10 days from one port in America to your Mumbai port location, then during that 10 days of time, you need to typically connect to the database or servers of the Maersk carriers and track the status of your shipment. So similarly, when a land carrier is carrying, then you need to communicate with a different organization. So which is a big painful process, right? And there is many times there is no standardization in the way the data is organized with these different organizations. So there are a lot of challenges in this global trade process. So hence, IBM thought that this is one place where blockchain can bring in transparency and trust among the different players of the network. So with that introduction to the supply chain, global trade supply chain process, let me dig into some of the interesting aspects of global trade. One first example is that the global trade is at a volume of 16 plus million trillion dollars in value that is happening every year across the world, and 80% of the goods that we are consuming today must have been coming imported from some other country. You don't know probably, but without knowing, we might be using these goods, right? 80% of them must have been imported by imported from some country, right? So this is the kind of volume of goods that get shipped, and World Trade Organization estimates that there is a possibility of $4 trillion global economy growth every year on year, and that translates to an increase of about 15% every year on year. So this is some interesting facts about global trade. So this is a one of the targeted domain for anybody to actually bring onto blockchain network. So if you want to bring these different participants onto blockchain network, what you need to do? So you can see today what happens is that these different participants, this is the carrier, this is the transportation organizations, right? And this is the land carriers. Land carrier can be a train, or it can be a barge, or it can be land inland services like lorries, lorry truck providers, right? So there are so many participants. Currently, what they are doing, if a carrier wants to communicate a document with some specific party, right? The buyer or the seller or the my downstream participant. For example, once the carrier reaches Maersk carrier reaches Mumbai port, from there the container need to be handed over to the inland carriers, that is the lorry service, the truck companies. So they need to communicate with them whether they have arrived to pick up this carrier or not. Until this container is picked up from this carrier, then the carrier cannot go, right? It has to first load that container and only then it can go. So there is a handshake between the adjacent parties who are handling the movement of the goods. So that handshake is today is happening completely in unorganized way and using some manual processes and paper based inefficient processes. So some of the problems with this current day process is that data is trapped in organization silos. Each organization is maintaining its own data by using its own standards and tools. So there is a lot of difficulty in sharing the data across the organizations is one big problem. The second one is manual time consuming paper based processes. Typically this data is tracked using papers and manually updates are made to the papers and manual handling. So passing the information from one party to the other party, manually they have to pass that information. So clearance take too long and is often subjected to fraud. So what can happen is that it requires a lot of follow-up for your upstream player to clear any process with respect to the goods movement. For example, in this case, without the customs clearance, the goods cannot be loaded onto the carriers. So what happens is that the container, after the land carrier reaches the port location, it will dump the container into the port location. It will keep the container lying in the port. Only after the customs authority clears the its processes, then only the container which is hosting your shipment. So container is a physical container. Your shipment, it cannot be loaded as is, right? So what typically happens is that it is loaded in a container and the container is carried by different vehicles. So until the customs clears that, the container may be lying here. So it cannot be loaded into the ocean carrier. So there is a delay. So all this causes in the, if you see the entire end-to-end goods shipment from the seller to the buyer, all these contribute to the overall delay, right? So we have to handle efficiently how to cut down this unnecessary delay. So this is one pain point. So this clearance, any clearance requires for the customs authority to clear the customs processes, they may be looking at some information which is missing currently. So they need to connect with the appropriate owners, collect that information, only then they can clear the their process. So on the other hand, if it is there, everything on the blockchain, then whoever is the party, we can provide appropriate access rights so that they can access the data instantly, and all these delays due to the processes involved can be cut down. So which can add to the efficiency or improvement in the entire process, right? So this is one direct benefit of having blockchain. And so one another disadvantage is that because of these delays and so on, there is a overhead in terms of the cost in the entire supply chain process. So we can cut down the entire cost also, because of if we can eliminate these inefficiencies, we can cut down the cost. So that is another important benefit by having blockchain in place. So with the blockchain, you can see that the communication is very clear now, and any user who is part of this network, for example, the ocean carrier, they knows that who is my upstream participant, who is my downstream participant, they will communicate accordingly. So that the time that is earlier getting wasted can be saved now. So what is brought to the blockchain network as part of representing this entire process onto blockchain? So we bring into the blockchain network the different shipment milestone related data. This data can be in the form of events, and this provides information about the shipment tracking progress. For example, start container tracking. Whenever the initially a container is allocated by the 3PL for a shipment, that time they create this statement called this event called state start container tracking, and then the container is carried by the trucker, and empty container is get out from the depot location, and it will go to the pickup location. The container is loaded onto the truck. So at that time, container stuffing completed at inland location. So these are the different events which provide the progress at different points in time. So all these events will now be part of blockchain network, TradeLens network. Hence, everybody will be able to access. So for example, my carrier, he knows that this is the shipment ID. Where is my shipment currently? He will just check, and if the shipment milestone is this level, so he knows that, okay, some land carrier is carrying the container which is containing my shipment. So he don't need to wait for when it is going to come. So this way, the downstream processes, they can also plan accordingly. For example, when to allocate a inland truck for the pickup from the carrier, ocean carrier. So typically there is a given schedule. So as per the schedule, they may be allocating the inland truck, but there may be unexpected delay in the process of shipment of the ocean carrier from the origin country to the destination country, right? There may be some 2 days of delay. Then if that information is not passed to the inland carrier, then he may be coming here and waiting for the shipment to arrive, right? Unnecessarily for 2 long days, he may be waiting here. So that will add additional cost towards the shipper's expenses, right? So we can cut down such kind of inefficiencies. Instead, if everything, all the milestones are tracked, he knows that, okay, the shipment has not yet reached the destination port, so let me not assign a truck for picking up this container today itself. So it takes 2 more days. Let me wait, and after 2 days, I can allocate a truck for the pickup. So that's how you can cut down the inefficiencies in the system if we have global visibility into the visibility into exactly the where exactly is the shipment is progressing right now. Right, so that is one example I'm just giving. So similarly, what other data we have? There are a lot of official documents that are required for the customs clearance or port access or loading your carriers, right? A lot of invoices are there, a lot of certificates are required, right? So you cannot just enter into the port without any proper entry pass. So that information will be tracked. So every information, the documents are tracked on the blockchain, and the progress of the events is tracked. So this is 2 pieces of information, right? So everybody can now have access to. So overall, what the TradeLens network will have? An ecosystem. What are all the participants? Shippers. Shippers are the buyers, you can say. And then freight forwarders, that is the 3PL organizations, third party logistic organizations is freight forwarders, and port and terminals, ocean carriers, and intermodal operators. Intermodal operators means land carriers. It can be a trucker, or it can be a train, or it can be a barge, and government authorities, and custom brokers. So all these are different parties which form the ecosystem of TradeLens. And what is the other component? This is the physical component, the platform. The platform itself, the blockchain platform, the TradeLens platform, which is built on top of Hyperledger Fabric blockchain platform in collaboration with this is started as a collaboration between IBM and Maersk. But today on TradeLens, there are many different carriers that are onboarded, and a lot of global trade data is tracked today using TradeLens. And then marketplace, because now all the data is available, a lot of other processes, other value-added services can be offered on top of this data. Because we have now all the data in one place, you can use that data in many different services so that the quality of service can be improved, or you can generate advanced alerts to the users saying that what is the progress of your, for example, there is a delay in the delivery date. Earlier the customer may be not having any clue when the delivery is going to happen. Now you can even predict, because there is a delay of 2 days in the washing carrier to reach the destination port. Now the entire process subsequently will also get delayed, typically by 2 more days. So you can generate an alert at the time of when, as and when you come to know that there is a delay in the washing carrier's delivery time. That time itself, you can create a alert which can be delivered to the receiver saying that your shipment is going to be delayed by 2 days. So that will give a lot of flexibility, right? So such kind of value-added services, customer satisfaction can be improved, so cost can be cut down. These are some of the examples of use of having blockchain in for the supply chain global trade, right? So if we see the collaborators more deeply, IBM and Maersk are the initial providers of this platform, but today, as I said, along with Maersk, there are a bunch of ocean carriers that are onboarded. Again, this is old data. We have today most of, more than 50% of the global trade is happening on trade lanes. So that translates to about 20 plus million containers per year are getting tracked using trade lanes. So 20 plus million containers is not a small amount, right? So there's so much of volume of data is tracked using trade lanes, and there is something called trade lanes. So as I said, there is a origin country, there is a destination country, and from origin to the destination, the shipment is in progress. In this process, typically there is a land carrier at the destination origin side, there is a ocean carrier, and there is a destination side land carrier. So there are three, typically goods movement involves three organizations at the minimum: a land carrier at the origin, and the ocean carrier, and a land carrier at the destination, right? So these are the three organizations in the minimum part of this entire process. On top of this, we can have port terminals, we can have customs authorities, and financial organizations. For example, it involves the organizations inland carriers. They are not servicing for free, right? They need to be paid for their services. Who will pay? Typically the shippers will pay. When the shippers will pay? Typically after receiving the goods. So it means that, for example, once the ocean carrier completes its service, the container is released from the carrier, it may take again a week time for the buyer to receive the goods. The ocean carrier may not want to wait for that much time before it receives its invoice. So there comes the financial organizations who will be financing the bills, the invoices, on behalf of the buyers and paying the carriers immediately after the carrier is done with the transportation, right? So that's how many different organizations keep coming and participating in this global trade process. Hence, the entire process becomes much more complex. So other members who are part of the global trade lanes are the network members. For example, there are different types of ocean carriers, there are different types of land carriers at the origin, at the destination, there are many ports and terminals, right? So so all these different participants can now be part of the network. One peer can be created, or peers can be shared among organizations, and they can be participating using a common peer in the network, right? So, and trade lanes clients, who are the clients? The shippers typically, and the financial institutions or the third party logistic services, they are all can be the clients of the trade lanes network. And what else we can do? Deployment partners. What it happens is that, as I said, there can be value added services that can be offered on top of this network. So let me take you through one of the value-added services that we created, which is accepted as a conference paper recently in the IEEE blockchain conference. And this is generation of e-invoices. as I am telling that the shipment is carried by different carriers, typically the three participants, and they generate invoices for their services. For example, the origin land carrier, the ocean carriers, destination land carriers, they generate invoices for their services. Now these invoices need to be cleared by the shipper, that is whoever is the buyer, they need to clear the invoice. Now remember the fact that this is not a one time process. So because it is a global trade, this trade keeps happening in large volumes every day, right, over the years. So what they do typically is that they have something called contractual agreements that are already set up. So for whenever there is a shipment is placed, for that specific shipment, they don't search for a land carrier at the origin or for a land carrier at the destination. They don't do that. There is already an agreement. For example, for 3 months, for every quarter, there is a contractual agreement. What it says is that every day, these many shipments are to be transported by this land carrier from this pickup location to this port location. So this agreement is already in place. And it also specifies that for this service, we pay at the rate of this much for each shipment, or based on the volume. Each shipment is measured, because all shipments are of the same size. They differ in terms of the volume it occupies. It requires, for example, multiple shipments can be clubbed and kept in single container. So that means that your shipment charge will be less. If your shipment is big, then your single shipment may be occupying one entire container. Then you cannot club your shipment with other shipments. Then what happens? You have to pay more amount for the transportation, right? So how much amount has to be paid? All this is already captured as part of the smart contract, part of contracts. Now, yeah, these are called the pre-existing contracts between the parties involved. So those contracts are available for us. And by looking at those contracts and how many number of shipments are shipped, we can actually automate this invoice generation process, which is carried out in our application. So this is more formally, I will define the problem now. So blockchain based invoice platform for global trade, what we do is that global container shipping, transportation of shippers goods across container country borders by loading into containers, and the goods movement involves typically land carriers, ocean carriers, and freight forwarders. The goods carrier organizations generate invoices for their services. So any carrier, it can be ocean or land carrier, they generate invoices. And what happens is, if there is any discrepancy in the invoice, that leads to disputes between the shipper and the carriers, because shipper is the party who is paying the amount. They verify whether I am paying the right amount. They don't want to, shippers don't want to pay excess amount, right? So they actually want to pay as per the contract only. Similarly, the carriers, they want to get paid as per the contract exactly. They don't want to get paid less amount. So if the invoice is generated by mistake by any of these parties, either less or more, the appropriate party will raise a dispute. Then that has to be settled. Only then, after the settlement of the invoice, it gets paid. So today, actually, in the global trade, this actually is contributing to a lot of amount. About 5% of the global trade amount is wasted because of the dispute settlements. So this is one place where you can actually automate the processes using blockchain, so that you can save this waste of money and also the time. Because dispute settlement typically takes a long time, in terms of at least 2 to 3 weeks time. So which is very huge, and till that time, the invoice won't get paid. So there is a lot of loss for the carriers, because they don't receive that amount on time. They will need to suffer a lot, right? So this is one of the value-add services in that way. So we propose a blockchain-based invoice generation system with the motivation as below. One is to reduce the number of disputes, and also, as I said, to reduce the dispute resolution time. With blockchain in place, it is expected that this entire dispute resolution can happen within few days, as opposed to within few weeks, right? So there is a lot of saving. So why this complexity is happening? Because of the en route handoffs between different parties involved. The goods movement is tracked now by different parties, right? So there is a handoff between many different parties while the goods is moving from the source to the destination. So because many organizations are involved and all of them don't use the same process today or don't store the data in single location, this inefficiency is coming into picture. And what happens is that because they want to generate the invoice in their favor, typically they end up collecting data which will establish saying that okay, whatever they are generating is true. So typically when they generate the invoice, they have to have some evidence of data. So because of this, we generated the invoice soon. So there is some penalty added because of there is a delay in the pickup time. So there is some waiting time. Hence we are adding this penalty. So they will prove that whatever they are generating is in accordance to whatever the data that they have. So they end up collecting some wrong data also, right? So this causes inefficiencies. When there is a wrong data collected and they generate invoice wrongly, obviously the shippers won't pay that. They will raise a dispute. Hence again, there is a delay. So what are the key features of the proposed blockchain-based invoice system? Service contract management. We have to manage the service contracts, as I said earlier, that exist between the different parties. At regular intervals, we have to refresh these service contracts. So for example, we have to maintain those contracts properly. There should not be any discrepancies in the contract itself, right? So, and the invoice generation is one of the functionality. Dispute management is one of the functionality that can be carried out using our system. And third one is interaction with the customers, enterprise resource planning systems. So we don't want to just have everything on the blockchain, but also we want to have integration with the clients. It can be any client. It can be a shipper. It can be a carrier organization, right? Or it can be a supplier, right? The sellers are called suppliers. So it can be a supplier organization. It can be any participant part of this network. We want to connect our system with their existing system so that it is very easy to migrate data between these two platforms. So those are all the design goals. And what is the solution approach? The traditional invoice is generated using one of these two options. One is traditional invoicing, where service providers generate the invoice and the shipper raises a dispute if there is any discrepancy. The second one is self-billing invoice. In this case, the shipper generates the invoice. So the traditional invoice is the service provider, that is the supplier generates the, that is the seller is generating the invoice and the shipper will clear it after he receives the goods. In the second case, self-billing, the shipper only will generate after receiving the goods and they will clear it, right? So in either of these methods, you can very clearly see that one party is only generating the invoice, which means that the other party also requires to validate that invoice, because the other party don't want to clear that without verification, right? So they may end up paying more money. So they need to validate the, whatever is followed by the generating organization. So which means that there is a redundancy now. One person is generating the invoice, they follow some process. The other person is validating the invoice. They also follow almost the same process and see that invoice generated is correct, right? So there is a redundancy in the verification and generation process. So can we remove that redundancy is the motivation. And yes, if we bring everything onto blockchain, we can remove this redundancy. Now the blockchain network using the smart contracts can generate automatically the invoices, and anybody can validate if the invoice is generating so much amount. They can validate why so much amount is generated. The invoice generated will contain some the additional data, like which is specific smart contract record is deferred, right? So all this will be included in the invoice. So by referring them directly, you can know that, okay, at what rate the invoice is generated, what are all the different charges part of the invoice, is there any penalty, for example, part of this invoice, if so, why the penalty is included. All this information can be tracked and verified instantly by any party. So before raising any dispute, somebody can verify it. Still, if they find any dispute, yes, there is a possibility still to raise a dispute, and that can be again tracked transparently on the blockchain platform and resolved. Right, so this is the architecture of our system. What we do is that we communicate with the trade length system. We get the shipment tracking information along with the shipment details itself. Because for our system, we don't directly interact with any other supply chain management service. We directly interact with the trade length system, which is actually having access to all the supply chain data. As we have already seen, all the participants who are part of the supply chain now are part of trade lens and which have entire access to data. So we now only import the shipment tracking events from the trade lens system. That is one information. And also we import what are the shipment details also. That is second piece of information. And third piece of information is what are the contractual agreements between different parties. For example, the carrier and shipper, what are the contractual agreements? Similarly, the land carrier at the destination and the shipper, what are the contractual agreements? So similarly, between shipper and every carrier organization, what is the contractual agreement we will track? So if we have this information, and whatever there is something called lane identification. As I was telling, there is a origin country and destination country. From origin one port to destination one port, the goods is getting shipped. But from any random origin to random destination, this won't happen. So in the global trade, they have pre-recognized origins and destinations. This transportation can happen between these pre-recognized origins and destinations only. Why? Because only along these pre-organized lanes, the different carriers are already because this shipping lane need to have in sync with the different carriers, right? So only these recognized lanes will be having the contractual agreements in place. So we don't need to waste any time in setting up the contractual agreements afresh for these existing lanes. So only we will consider those lanes. And today, many more lanes are getting ready with this contractual agreements automated, and they are getting onboarded. So once this required information in terms of contractual agreements is available with the other lanes also, they can be onboarded to trade lanes, and subsequently they can be onboarded to our system as well. So once all this information is there, the invoice is generated. Typically, the invoice consists of the following format: what is the invoice ID, what is the amount, and what is the currency. And invoice is not single flat amount. It consists of a lot of charges. So what are the array of charges, set of charges part of this invoice? Now each charge or fee again contains an ID, and there are different ways the charge is computed. Example, the charge can be a planned or unplanned or ad hoc value added charge. That means planned charge means irrespective of how much time the carrier is taking for the transportation of that specific shipment, it will charge a fixed amount. That is called planned charge. Unplanned means based on the delay, it will end up adding some additional charges. For example, at the destination, the unloading of the container from the ocean carrier is getting delayed. They need to add something called detention and demurrage charges. That is one standard charge that is charged by the ocean carriers. So this detention and demurrage charge is added only if there are delays in terms of unloading the container from the ocean carrier. right? So based on the amount of delay, if it is 2 days delay or 3 days delay or 7 days delay, based on the delay, they add penalty charges. So those kind of charges are tracked using unplanned charges. So similarly, there are ad hoc charges. Once the invoice is complete, is ready and issued to the shippers and carriers, at that time, if the carriers verify and say, see that, okay, some charge is missed as part of this invoice computation, so then they can add ad hoc charges into our system for that invoice. Similarly, the computation type. So the computation of each charge can be a fixed process maybe there using which you compute the charge, or there may be the process may be variable. What it means by variability is that you need to track some events, and based on the when the events are taking place, the milestone events, that is the I showed right in the global shipment process, there are so many milestone events happening. So when a specific milestone event is happening, based on that, we compute some charges. So those are all called under variable, and variable formula is that, again, this is again event-based, milestone event-based computation method, but there is certain formula which can be configured by the parties dynamically. So whatever is the variable formula-based computation, we use at that point in time and compute the charge. So these are different ways that we compute the charges, and there is a price. Again, there is a currency here. This currency is required to be maintained at the charge level, at the invoice level. Why? Because the charges may be generated by different parties, and the charge may be generated using different currency also, because the import and export countries are different. The currencies of import and export countries may be different. For example, in the example that we considered, the export country is USA, so the charges will be generated using USD as the currency unit, whereas for the import country that is in Mumbai, the charges are generated in terms of INR, Indian rupees. So there is a conversion also required. So all that we have to take care. So that information, that piece of information again is tracked using the invoice as the lineage information. What is the conversion rate we used if the charges are in different currencies, and also what is the specific contract rate we used for charging, right? So this is one piece of information. And in the computation itself, we have some differences, like what is the trigger criteria and issue criteria, which means that at what point in time you have to start computing the charge. What we are doing is that in the typical scenario where the shipment is delivered to the shipper, at that point in time the invoice gets generated for all the three carriers involved in the goods shipment process. But that is an inefficient process, because the origin side land carrier is done with its service much earlier, but it has to wait using the current day processes. It has to wait till the goods shipment is completed. Only then the invoice gets generated and it gets paid. But using blockchain, we know that as soon as the container is loaded onto a ocean carrier, the origin side land carrier is done. So you don't need to keep the origin side land carrier waiting for its invoice gets cleared. So we generate the invoice at that moment itself. So that is called the trigger criteria. What is the point at which you can start computing an invoice for a party? And then the issue criteria is till what time you need to wait, because there may be some updates required in the invoice. So after certain point in time, there are no updates entertained and the invoice is freezed and it will be settled. So that is called the issue criteria. So we follow these standards and generate the invoices automatically. So if you see on blockchain, what are the different workflows that happen in the auto invoice generation process are, the entire process starts with the shipper onboarding the data. He has to onboard the contractual agreements and lane informations, like which are the origin lanes, destination lanes, and these lanes who are all the parties providing the service, and what are the contractual agreements of shipper with those carriers. So all that information is loaded first. Then once that load is, that information is loaded to blockchain, that information is written to the ledger also by all the peers. So lien invoice, fees, rates, what are the liens, what are the invoices to be generated, what are the charges or fee included that is part of the each invoice, and what are the contractual rates. So all this information is committed by each peer, and then we start getting shipment details from TradeLens shipment tracking system. Example is TradeLens. Once we get the shipment information, that information is first written to the peers. Then we will identify which shipments we are interested for e-invoice generation, because there may be different shipments which are not part of this lane. For those shipments which are not part of this lane, we don't want to generate the invoice. So we will do some filtering process here and generate the only filter data, that is the selected shipments only we generate the invoices. So once we identify the selected shipments, so we call invoice fee computation method, that is a call to the smart contract, and the smart contract, which is part of the chain code and installed on the peer, that is now getting executed, and it computes the invoice. So at this point in time, we have access to the invoice, but the invoice may need to be updated. So if there are any real-time shipment tracking events, updates that we receive for this shipment, then we make a subsequent call to the chain code to update this existing invoice. So those invoices are updated now. So after some point in time, we freeze the invoice and the invoice can be paid. So these are so the different parties involved here in this process are shipper is the main process, and we get the tracking information from TradeLens, and we have a blockchain utility. This is the API service provider, and we have the peers. So probably I will not go through the fee state management. One important thing is that what is the advantage that it brings in to the system? Dispute workflow, as I said, now can be very less time consuming earlier in versus existing process. Existing process, what it does is that invoice contains different fees. Now all the fees are computed and added to the invoice one by one, and the different fee may be added at different points in time. So the invoice is kept open, and only after all the fees are computed and added to the invoice, at that time the invoice is issued to the shippers and carriers. So by this time itself, there is a lot of waiting, so that adds to the total delay in the payment processing. And once the invoice is open for access to the carriers and shippers, then they start raising disputes, and the dispute resolution may take its own time. So finally, the invoice is finalized. At that time, we can pay the invoice. So this is a very lengthy time-consuming process. What we do with the blockchain-based invoicing is that we don't issue the invoice as a whole. Instead, we issue each fee individually. So I have 10 fee part of my invoice. As and when my one of the fee is ready, I keep issuing. So if there is a dispute that is required, immediately the either the shipper or the carriers will raise a dispute. Hence, the dispute can be settled much earlier to what it would have taken in the traditional process. So this actually that way improves a lot of time. It saves a lot of time and cost as well. So what we identified is that the system that we built is able to process about 235 transactions per second, where a transaction means that generation of an invoice, which includes the different charges by considering the contracts and the shipment tracking details. So our system, the invoice generation system, when used with some real world data from some shippers, what it was giving the output is about 235 transactions we are able to process per second. We are able to generate the invoices. So when I say invoice, it translates to generation of typically three different invoices for the shipment. So all three invoices are part of one single transaction, and we are able to process up to 235 transactions per second. Now, if you see what is today's demand, today we have about 802 million TEUs, that is 20-foot equipment units. What it means is that this is one standardization, because the different shipments require different volumes, as I said earlier. So if you cannot count the volume of shipments to assess total how many number of shipments are there, you need to translate that into volume, and you have to say total how much volume of shipments is transported by the global trade industry. So this is when converted into this TEU standard, 20 foot equipment. This is the container size, actually. 20 foot container is the standard container. So we have 802 million container units that are involved in the goods transportation every year. So that translates to about 25 containers per second. So if you are able to generate the invoices for 25 containers per second, then your system is graduating to be deployed in the global trade ecosystem for generating the invoices in real time. But we are able to generate at a throughput of 235 transactions, which is more than 10 times what is the demand, the requirement today. So hence, we are confident that when the system, such a system, is actually deployed in real customer environments, it can actually serve the purpose without any performance issues. So the third one is the food trust. So this is another big value-added network that is offered on top of Hyperledger Fabric. So today, if you see the food ecosystem, there are four major bottlenecks. One is food safety, supply chain inefficiency, food wastage, and food fraud. Food safety means 1 out of 10 people get sick every year because of foodborne illness. There is food contamination or whatever it is. 1 out of 10 is suffering from illness because of food problems. Second one is 80% of business is partial is done using paper-based documentation. It's not in PDF or EDA formats. It is still paper-based. 80% of the tracking is done using papers. So that's a huge inefficiency. So similarly, food waste. 1/3 of food today we are consuming is getting wasted. And food fraud. So there is a lot of fraud also that happens intentionally, unintentionally, unintentionally in the sense due to manual errors. Intentionally, somebody is explicitly trying to fool the system, right? So there is about 1/5 of fraud is happening among the volume of food that is being consumed, right? So these are all huge inefficiencies in the food ecosystem today. So can we have blockchain in such an environment to bring efficiency into the system is the problem. So if you see, the players of food ecosystem will be the growers, food growers, the first participants. Second one is manufacturers, and then the logistics service providers, and also some ingredient providers also can be part of the ecosystem. And logistics service providers, once the product is ready, the logistics service providers help take the transport the products to the retailers. Retailers are the shops, right? And then the consumers, it can be directly consumers are buying from the retail stores and consuming that, or the restaurants who are one more participant in the supply chain network. So these are all the different participants. Now, can we, what are the inefficiencies with these people? One is, as I already said, the communication is today is happening using paper-based mechanisms. And there are a lot of intermediaries between any of these two players. So what happens if the logistics service provider, he wants to collect some information from the grower, then he needs to approach via the manufacturer or somebody middleman. So there is a loss of time and also inaccurate data. There is a possibility of getting inaccurate data, right? So all these are all causing inefficiencies in the system. And more than that, data is siloed. I have two different logistics service providers. They maintain their own databases, and I don't know, my shipment is shipped using two different logistics service providers to a retail store. Now I don't know as a whole my shipment when it will is going to reach the retail store, right? So because they have different ways to track the systems. So these are all the inefficiencies in the system. Now can we bring all these participants? Just to go back to one of the questions that is asked earlier, what is a channel? So now this forms a channel, and these different parties in the food ecosystem, they are all part of this channel. So all of them can see the channel data. So similarly in the trade lens network, all the trade lens participants will form a channel. They all can see the data that is available in the channel. So here, if entire data is accessible to all the participants, assuming that there is no privacy concern, then anybody can instantly query and see when my food is grown, when my this specific product is manufactured, what is the expiry date. I can instantly come to know, right? I can query any information that is available publicly here in this channel, and I can be a retailer, I can be a end user like restaurant or individual consumer. I may be playing any role, and I can access that data as long as it is available in this channel, right? So this is one efficiency, and instant transparency. We can provide data transparency, and data is immutable. Nobody cannot create any fraud. As we have seen, fraud is one of the challenges in the food ecosystem. As I said, 1/5 of food is fraudulent. So such kind of frauds, fraudulent transactions, we can eliminate. And also dispute resolution here also, because many different parties are transacting. For example, grower and manufacturers are transacting. So if there is any dispute between them, then that can be very easily resolved using blockchain network, because there is already a smart contract in place which says what is the agreement, who is violating the agreement. You can easily track, and accordingly you can penalize whoever is violating the agreement, right? Earlier it was very difficult to establish who is actually violating the agreement, right? So I will go over some of the use cases that are helpful in solving some of the existing clients' pain points. So I will come back to some of these benefits after I go over the use cases. So different parties, as we saw, the growers, the food manufacturers, wholesalers or distributors, and food logistic, this is the third party logistic providers, right? The transportation companies and food retailers. These are all the primary participants of the food ecosystem, and all of them can see benefits being on the blockchain. For example, the wholesalers, they need to maintain their inventory, right? Inventory management is a big problem for any wholesalers. They have to manage what is the stock currently I have in my store, right? What is the expiry date for associated with the different products? And when I need to acquire new goods, how much time it will take for the goods to receive my store? So all this is comes under the inventory management, right? So that inventory management, now doing it in isolation with the other parties in communication is very difficult. Now if everything is on blockchain, they can very easily track which are all the manufacturers, how much quantity they have, what is the price at which they are offering. So when is the right time to acquire that goods? So how much time, if the manufacturer is located at some place, it may take, he knows that from the historical data, it takes this much time for the goods to receive, to get delivered to my store, right? So they can plan all the things accordingly. They will perform their transactions. So this is just one example that inventory management by the distributors becomes very easy if everybody is on the supply chain, right? So similarly, food retailers. Earlier, they don't know there is something called targeted recalls. Whenever there is food contamination, they need to recall a bunch of products that are together brought. For example, there is a food contamination in a specific lot of milk packets. So then somebody reported that some health issue has occurred because I consumed this milk packet. Then the retail store owner, they will track that where is the source of this milk. So possibly all the other packets are also having this problem, contaminated. So let me recall all these packets. So if it is not yet sold, I will just not ensure that they are not sold to anybody. If it is already sold, at least they can reach out to those people and inform them not to consume and so on, right? So food recall, at least ensuring that the provenance from where it is coming, and then accordingly ensure that where all it is transported and it is not further consumed in the supply chain downstream. So that all can be done now in a very organized manner if you have this entire data tracked on the blockchain. So that is one use case. So likewise, with every participant here, there are different use cases. So let us start with one use case with Walmart. So Walmart, what it does is that leafy greens can be source of foodborne illness, and Walmart wanted to take proactive action to ensure that optimal response in case of an outbreak. So if some outbreak is disease outbreak is identified because of some leafy green being consumed, then earlier it was taking a lot of time for them, many days, to track what is the source of this leafy green, from which location it is coming, and where all the different lots are delivered from this location, and then they need to recall that those lots are not sold, right? So tracking that information was many days consuming process. Now what they identified is that if entire data is on blockchain, it took them few seconds actually to track, okay, which are all the stores where this specific farm being the origin of this leafy green, the product is delivered to which all stores. They could now store in few seconds and they can recall that product. So that is one efficiency that they attained. So similarly, Carrefour. So they actually found the problem is that their consumers demand more information on their food products, from where they are coming, and what are the sustainability practices that are followed using during the process of growing the chicken, right? So they wanted to have more visibility into, the customers wanted to have more visibility into this kind of information. So that is the specific pain point of this organization. So retailers lack this information currently. The retail stores don't know. They just are selling that product, but they don't know more about this provenance information. So what happened is that when this information is brought onto the blockchain, the retailers were able to provide this information to the consumers using the QR codes and other techniques, right? This is very easy to track and make available this information with the retailer so that they can provide to the consumers further. What is the impact because of this? It increased the revenues, and there is a significant jump in the revenue after they started using the blockchain for provenance tracking of these products. So this is one use case. So similarly, the third use case is the cold chains. So some of the products like Golden State Foods, this is one organization. So their big problem is that whatever the food that they are selling, the freshness of the food, they need to guarantee how fresh is that food. The freshness is depending on many different factors, like when it is, the product is created is one thing, how it is maintained. For example, in the cold chains, the food is stored. At what temperatures the food is stored in the cold chains, that also impacts a lot on the food freshness. If there is a recommended temperature of 25 degrees to store this product in a cold chain, it is kept at 50 degrees centigrade, for example, then it will get destroyed very easily, damaged very easily. In against, if another cold store is storing as per the recommendation at 25 degrees centigrade itself, for example, then there is high probability, high chance that the freshness is maintained. Hence, the restaurants can guarantee to their clients saying that, okay, my whatever the food product I am serving is at more quality than the other food, other restaurants, right? So they can claim this only if they have this information in hand. So so this is one specific application which is blockchain plus IoT based and analytics based application. What additional analytics they can do is that the, for example, the restaurant, once they have access to all these raw materials, when they are servicing to the clients, they can even plan which specific lot has to be consumed first, which specific lot can be consumed later. So that way they can maximize the utilization of the food products. So that will further increase their revenue also, right? So this is a specific use case based on blockchain, IoT and analytics based use case. And this turned out to be one of the huge successful projects using blockchain. The another example is Coffee Farmer platform. What it does is that the coffee trading was seeing very low in the business. Many reasons, actually, the growers are because they are not finding any profits in the coffee growing business, they were migrating to other businesses. So that was impacting the coffee supply chain as a whole. So they wanted to bring this entire system onto blockchain. So what happened is that because now it moved to blockchain, the demand also increased. The consumers started consuming more coffee and the demand increased. Because the demand is increased, more farmers are now getting motivated to come into this specific business and grow the coffee products. And also there are tips, donations provided to the farmers by the consumers directly at the coffee outlets, right? So they can actually donate the tips directly to the farmers. So that is one biggest feasibility that is possible because of blockchain. Earlier it was clueless. We don't know who is the farmer who is growing my coffee, right, that I'm consuming in a store, coffee chain. But now using IFT kind of solutions around, it is possible to track that this specific coffee bean is coming from so-and-so farm, and who are the farmers owning that farm and so on. All that information is available, and any tip that is given by the customers can be directly handed to the farmers. So that was increasing their profits. So they came back to this business again, and they see that there is a lot of jump in the business after adopting blockchain based solutions in this industry. So another one is Ecuador Shrimp Partnership, this SSP. What happened is that this Ecuador, they were actually following very nice the sustainability practices, and they were actually generating high quality shrimp, but they are unable to prove that they are, when compared to their peers who are in the same industry, they are providing a better quality product. They are unable to prove, hence their profits were much profitable. Actually, they could have sold the same product at a much higher price, but because they don't have a mechanism to prove the fact that they are following richer practices, so they cannot sell it at higher cost. So what happened is they came to blockchain, IBM Food Trust, and because their process is now on blockchain, so consumers now can have direct visibility into the kind of practices they undertake during the food growing process. Hence, they established themselves as a brand, and they started seeing a huge jump in their revenue. So they can now sell the products at much higher price also, which the consumers are ready to consume at higher price also, because they have a proof that it is worth spending that much amount, right? So the traceability in most of these applications, tracing from where my food is coming, is the biggest pain point that we are solving. So going back just to end the session, right? So there are many different use cases to track the food provenance and the food freshness. And there are applications around IoT based plus blockchain and analytics based applications to different forms of these food supply chains. And that can bring in a lot of benefits by eliminating the existing inefficiencies, right? So this is one sample blockchain network that is food supply chain. So today, actually, this same food supply chain is catering to many other different supply chain industries, like tires, tire industry. American Tire Distributors is one client that is working with IBM food supply chain network. So and there are many other different domains actually that are coming into use of blockchain for traceability, provenance tracking. So that's where I want to stop. Maybe we can take few queries if you have.
Yes, chain, land transfer related applications.
Similar to supply chain, can blockchain be used in land transfer selling related applications? Yes, definitely. Whenever there are multiple parties involved, definitely we can use supply chain solutions. Even multiple parties is two parties is also sufficient. Whenever there is a seller and there is a buyer, we can use supply chain to cut down inefficiency in terms of transportation, right? Or whether my invoice is getting generated in accordance with the contractual agreement or not. So we can use.
Any other questions? Thank you, Krishna Suri, for such a wonderful and informative presentation. And it is good to know how blockchain can be used in, you know, in all these applications, actually, in this food supply chain. And even we can, you know, check freshness of a food using the technology now.
Yes.
So, yes, very good to know. And it is very good to know about all these projects on which, you know, you are involved in or working with or IBM is working on. So thank you so much once again. I hope all the participants have enjoyed the Hyperledger Fabric, which is actually a foundation of developing modular architecture applications and solutions. So in the next session, maybe we will have, you know, actually gets our hand dirty and we will actually do practical on Hyperledger Fabrics. I already roll out the instructions which are provided by Mr. Abhishek to get your system ready so that you can also do the practical hand in hand. So I hope all the participants will make their system ready.